Well, the ambitious Make in India Week kicked off with a slew of announcements from the Maharashtra Chief Minister Devendra Fadnavis today. The state announced the Trans Harbour Sea Link, new airports in Navi Mumbai and in Pune would be expedited. The ease of doing business for construction and for industry, there's now a new single window clearance as well. Ruchi Deshpande sent us this report where the big bang announcements were made earlier today.
Clearly, the ease of doing business was the main agenda that CM Devendra Fadnavis is using to attract investments here at the Make of India Week, day three of Make in India Week. Now, just to get you a little more detail about it, the Chief Secretary, Mr. Swadin Kshatriya, told us today that aiming at the ease of doing business, he highlighted projects like the Maharashtra Trans Harbour Link as well as the Navi Mumbai International Airport, where he said that all the decisions regarding these projects will be transparent. He will also have a system set up for faster clearance of these two as well as the other infrastructure projects in Mumbai. He also mentioned further that they will delegate powers of 18 departments into one department and that whoever is applying for this will only have to go through one application and there will be no need of an affidavit. Self-certification will be enough to get a clearance for any project. Adding to this, the Union Minister for Environment, Mr. Prakash Javadekar, said that that the Ministry of Environment has also provided clearances of 943 projects worth almost 6.5 lakh crore rupees. He also said that from the point of view of making this easy for the real estate sector, he will have a single window clearance for environment set up in the next two or three coming months. Moving on, the Chief Secretary also said that they have modified the Right to Services Act, due to which 157 services have been modified and about 250 of them will be available online, that is on the Maitri portal. So clearly the MIDC as well as the Maharashtra government is working towards attracting more investments by the way of ease of doing business.
Well, Rishi, obviously on this channel we focus on the real estate, and the Chief Minister made some big announcements on the state's plans for affordable housing. Ruchi sent us this report on affordable housing. Let's listen in.
Build in Mumbai, that is the next initiative that the Maharashtra Chief Minister Devendra Fadnavis is aiming at here on the third day of the Make in India Week that has been held in Bandra Kurla Complex in Mumbai. Now, moving on further, what he said on this was the fact that he highlighted the problem of creating affordable housing in a city like Mumbai, but on the brighter side, he mentioned that housing body CREDAI has pledged 400,000 houses, affordable houses, to be built in Mumbai, whereas NAREDCO has pledged about 100,000 houses to be built over here. He further added that SRA or the Slum Rehabilitation Authority will get into an agreement with a consortium to come up with 4 lakh houses to be provided in the affordable housing segment. He also said that the Swedish government had expressed interest in investing in affordable housing and that he will soon sign an MOU with it. So clearly the Maharashtra government is also leaving no stone unturned when it comes to affordable housing, in addition to looking after attracting investments.
All right, Ruchi, many thanks for joining us on the show with all of those details. Well, joining me on the show right now to help us understand what all of this means for the real estate sector, Amit Goenka, Managing Director and CEO at Nisus Finance Mumbai, joins me in the studio. Rohit Poddar, Managing Director at Poddar Developers, and Amit Grover, National Director, Offices Business at DLF, joining us from Delhi. Gentlemen, thank you so much for coming in and to have this conversation with us. Amit Goenka, I'm going to start with you first. It seems like a massive success, you know, other than that one incident of the fire that we had on Sunday night. If we just focus on the investment and the money that's been pledged to India over Make in India right now, would you call this event a success?
I would think it's the right step in the right direction, and clearly it is about espousing confidence about the people who matter, the lawmakers, the decision makers, the legislators coming forward and giving that confidence to the investors, the global community at large, that we mean business and we're here to support the initiative. So clearly it's a right message. Now, whether that message is actually delivered into action is what really needs to be seen. We've been seeing a number of announcements in the past. Clearly there have been delays also to those announcements. We've been talking about Trans Harbour Link, we've been talking about Coastal Road, we've been talking about creating a larger infrastructure. But clearly in the last 1.5 years in the Maharashtra government, we've really seen, talks. There might have been impediments, but we haven't seen that plan actually, you know, go into action yet. So clearly,
if we focus on the announcements we heard today, and I'm just looking at these two, Trans Harbour Link and Navi Mumbai Airport to be expedited by the state government, paying a lot of attention to getting it done as quickly as possible. What does that mean for the real estate sector in Mumbai at least?
Well, so far as the Navi Mumbai Airport goes, I think that fact has already been concerned into the pricing of that micro market. So clearly there was a lot of euphoria in and around Panvel over the last 10 years. There was a lot of land buying, huge amount of townships got announced. Those townships are nowhere near to actually seeing the light of the day. And if the airport does come up, then I think I'm more hopeful that these townships will eventually get delivered because people will start looking at it.
But do you see it providing a fillip to the rates? Do you expect rates to go up further if we actually see an airport in brick and mortar show up on the
road? I don't think rates can actually go up further because as I said, the prices have already been factored in considering that infrastructure. What can actually happen is that people will start potentially looking at it as a serious alternative destination to stay and do business out of. And that will gradually start moving the population, the business environment towards that. Maybe it will take time for the prices to actually start moving up thereafter. But in the near future, I don't see any sort of impact on the prices because they're already under pressure to correct now in that area.
Rohit Poddar, do you agree that they don't see any sort of fillip for prices in the near at least in the near time?
Well, I think I agree with my friend Amit. My view is that actually prices in real estate are basically a derivative of the GDP growth. And also, I mean, 7.6% growth is really not where the market's actually at. We're still, I think, sub 5. Industrial output is still pretty low. So I think unless you have growth in the economy with job creation, the chances of property prices rising are sort of bleak to none. In Panvel in particular, as far as the airport is concerned, we're still many years away from the completion of the airport. They're still talking about the construction starting towards the end of this year, both for the Trans Harbour Sea Link as well as the airport. They're looking at a 4 to 5 year window for the completion of it. So I don't see any demand drivers as such in the foreseeable future to increase prices.
Well, let's talk about the larger investments that we saw announced at the Make in India event. And this is just day one. There are 5 more days to go from what I understand. So we're going to see an entire list of money being pledged to this, to Make in India. Amit Grover, from a commercial space point of view, how important is Make in India right now?
Well, actually, these are very encouraging investments and initiatives and good to see that Maharashtra is taking a startup leap because every time there is investment in the infrastructure, whether it is the airport or the highways, that builds the investor confidence, whether it's the FDI coming in or existing companies expanding in those locations. It does have a immediate impact of a positive outlook towards those locations, and in a medium term to long term have a positive impact in the commercial space take up. We've seen locations like Hyderabad and Gurgaon majorly benefiting when the large infrastructure initiatives have been announced, when the new airports have come up here. It becomes much more convenient for the international decision makers to come, travel, access these cities. It becomes easier for the employees who come day to day to their offices to easily commute in the least impact to their work-life balance. So definitely there's an impact of positive uptake in the commercial space. And what is also important is that then the entire ecosystem around these locations start developing. You get better roads, so you get better access to some of the collaborative transport. The structured players step in who provide the cabs, buses. The overall metro connectivity to such locations definitely have an impact in how the commercial space take up is. So I think it's an overall impact to these locations which start emerging in the medium term to long term.
Well, Amit Grover, I have to be specific now because I have two Amits on the panel. Amit Grover, if someone's looking at making an investment at this point into real estate, would you recommend they then look at commercial property instead of the vanilla residential property?
Well, it's, if you go by the trends in India, the first is by default the residential steps in first, and then the commercial takes the leap, because commercial ensures that there is enough catchment and the workforce around.
Sure.
So by default, the trend has been first the residential. Commercial takes a hedging call once the ecosystem is developed, and then takes a bet on the locations.
Well, Amit Goenka, same question to you. If I were looking right now to make a pure investment, given the kind of action that we're seeing in Make in India, do you expect it to have any sort of impact on the residential sector? Or do you think it's only those investors who have access to commercial who might profit from this?
Well, actually, you're right. Those who have had commercial assets today seem to be in the firmest footing.
Mm.
You know, so you look at a couple of the largest developers in Bangalore who've now expanded their footprint and have come to Mumbai, have gone to Kolkata, whereas those who've been in residential have had to consolidate themselves in their local markets or into their backyards.
Mm.
So people who thought they could become pan-India have actually had to consolidate. But commercial asset class is not that specific to the sentiments or to the idiosyncrasies of the local market, whether it comes to design, whether it comes to the cultures, etc., because it's a standardized product and people are able to roll out their designs and their products from market to market. So those who have built these long-term assets seem to have profited the most from it. Even when you look at Gurgaon, there are tons of square feet that came up in Gurgaon, and the residential is just about getting delivered in the last 4 to 5 years, whereas the office asset creation started long time back, where people said, well, maybe we'll have to travel 10 kilometers from Delhi or 20 kilometers from Delhi, but we're going to go into modern offices, we're going to go into, you know, something which is absolutely meeting the infrastructure requirement of the global corporations. So I see that also as one of the shifts today. When you had the Reliance move to Navi Mumbai or towards Turbay, you really saw micro markets getting developed around that, where people said, okay, now a large employer is going to set up a footprint, you know, let's go out and start also creating an infrastructure, eco-socio-economic system around that. So I do see that long-term assets are really the block builders for the economy, for the micro-market developments, for creating the Make in India environment as well. So when you have warehouses going into places like Nandi Hills in Bangalore, or whether you have in Red Hills in Chennai, to the port areas, to Bhiwandi and places around Bhiwandi in Maharashtra, to the northern corridors, that's really when you start seeing a lot of affordable housing also come up around those belts to cater to the people who are so far traveling and have to actually go to work in these industrial belts, in these SEZs, in these high job influx infrastructure developments. So
sure.
Clearly, I think the whole push of Make in India will allow for these industrial assets, for manufacturing assets to get created, warehousing and logistics assets to get created, which in turn will lead to large amount of population influx, job creation and thereabouts building of the related habitable environment
sure.
around them.
You know, Amit, does that mean that Nandi Hills, Bhiwadi, the northern corridors that you just mentioned, are these the new hotspots for investment?
Absolutely. In fact, I mentioned also when I look at Bangalore, for example, we've taken a recent bet on Hoskote. Now, Hoskote is not a very favorite residential
sure.
area. It's really an industrial area. Whereas we've also looked at, or we made investments also in northern Bangalore, whether it's Thani Sandra or Yalanka, etc., which are still the more infill locations because
sure.
of Manyata Tech Park, etc. But we've taken a slightly contrarian or a longer bet on Hoskote, which is clearly an industrial belt. Now we're seeing a huge amount of influx going in there for affordable housing. People are gradually, you know, coming in and starting to settle because of Volvo manufacturing, so many other setups.
What sort of upside
up.
Do you see on that sort of affordable housing?
Well, it's very clear. I mean, for something, a micro market which is about 7 kilometers away from a market which is at about 6,000 rupees, I can make a housing available there for about 3,500 rupees or 4,000 rupees. So clearly, what Thani Sandra has seen, a 40% upside, or Yalanka has seen, I see that now happening for Hoskote in the next 2 to 3 years. So these are the industrial corridors, these are the industrial belts which are poised to see the largest amount of influx growth from being affordable
okay.
and approachable.
So The largest growth from being approachable, affordable, I don't know so much. If I were to compare the IT corridors to the industrial corridors, are you telling me I'll get better returns from the industrial corridors?
I would think so, at least now going forward, especially if the plans of the government were to bear any fruition. And I would again want to qualify that the plans that the government is building have to bear fruition. They're not one-off sort of events or one-off announcements. There needs to be a sustained growth in the GDP and sustained amount of development on the industrial side. But certainly, because IT is an overplayed story, everybody has rushed into the IT corridors, whether it's Whitefield in Bangalore, whether it's Navi Mumbai and Thane in Mumbai, whether it's Gurgaon, whether it is Noida, you know, whether it's, you know, Pune, Hinjewadi, which was selling at 1500 rupees, has started selling at 7000 rupees and made it unaffordable. So clearly, the IT story has been played out in a very large way. The residential prices have shot up very, very significantly over a short period of time, and a large amount of build-out continues to happen in these corridors. So I see the upside to be very, very limited, whereas it's really now the making of the new industrial corridors which will now start making affordable, more habitable locations possible. People, right, which are again within the vicinity of the ID corridors, by the way.
All right. Our phone lines are open. If you'd like to pick up the phone and call us and ask us about investing in property anywhere across the country, feel free to do so. Rohit Poddar, you know, let's talk about affordable housing since Amit brought it up. And if we calculate all of the announcements that the Chief Minister of Maharashtra made today, he's talking about 9 lakh affordable homes, maybe in the next 5 years, if I'm not mistaken. That's a lot of supply coming into a market. How do we see any sort right. of rise in prices if we're competing with the supply like that?
Well, I mean, I think I'm quite very skeptical about hearing numbers of this nature. Various bodies have submitted plans in the past for various number of houses and nothing's actually come up. In addition to houses coming up, remember, infrastructure has to come up along with it as well. So, for example, if you're making, you know, lakhs of apartments in Mumbai or the MMR area, you need water, electricity, roads, mass urban transport, you need infrastructure to develop, train services to become faster and more frequent, you know, all those things as well. And they have to be, it has to be a balanced development, schools, colleges, hospitals, entertainment options all coming up. And frankly speaking, I simply don't see that happening, dovetailing with 9 lakh apartments coming up. I think the Chief Minister is very serious about housing for all, and we hope that the single window clearances, which have been promised for almost 15 years now, actually becomes a reality. We think that under this Chief Minister it actually will. So I look forward to apartments coming up. I think it'll be good for the market in general and for us as a company as well. From a perspective of additional supply coming in.
Rohit, what neighborhoods?
I think my analysis is that you'll see.
What neighborhoods are you focusing on right now?
Well, we're focusing on the western line, the central line. So we're currently projects on the central line. So you've got, the affordable destinations would be Kalyan, its periphery, Shahpur, Artgaon, Badlapur, Karjat. And then you've got a project coming up in the outskirts of Panvel and another one basically in Vasai. So we're sort of covering central, western and harbour. We haven't been able to manage Payne yet because it's not a local stop as of now. So we're basically covering the MMR area on the local suburban train.
All right, very interesting. Karjat there, Amit Goenka, we've had a couple of conversations on this show. It's being mentioned, Karjat's being mentioned as an affordable housing destination and possibly a destination that will eventually be part of the larger region of Mumbai. What sort of future do you see for Karjat as an investment?
So Karjat has, like Boisar, had come up as a sudden alternative to affordable housing because of, as Rohit rightly mentioned, because of train stoppages, because a number of rakes being made available for Karjat as a destination, and therefore the ability of people to actually reach that location. I have seen in the last 1.5 years alone, close to almost about 600 acres of development being planned in and around Karjat. And especially the Neral Badlapur belt, which means that there is a very huge influx of affordable housing, starting from 5-7 lakh homes to going up to even about 20 lakh homes. And people who are obviously buying there with a view that eventually Karjat or Badlapur will become a livable destination for the masses. People do stay there, but they still are traveling maybe to Kalyan, or maybe they're traveling a good 15-20 kilometers to go to work. But it's still a very, very affordable location for people who have so far not been able to buy a 5-10 lakh rupee home. So clearly Karjat is providing that option for now. For the entire build-out to happen, for influx of industries and for the social infrastructure to come in, I think it'll take quite some time before the critical mass actually starts to move into Karjat mm-hmm. as a livable destination. But
well, would so you far, recommend it to an investor at this point who wanted to take advantage of that growth that we'll see happen over the next few years?
As I said, a lot of influx of development is there, and till such time that influx is not eased out, when build out has happened and it slows down a bit and people start actually moving into homes, you don't see any potential of price rise, because everybody's competing to sell that massive development at whatever price that they can afford,
sure.
which is why a 5 or 7 or 10 lakh home is being made available. So a 3,000 rupee a square foot, 400 square feet homes, 250 square feet homes, small apartments. So it's really a fight for affordability and for eyeballs. Until such time that entire absorption or bulk of it really goes off, a price escalation looks slightly tough going forward. So I would not rush an investor into that micro market already. I would want them to wait till
Rohit Poddar, would you agree with that investors should stay out of this market for the time being? It should ideally just remain an end user market?
Well, I mean, I would say this. In the last 1 year, there's been no appreciation across any affordable housing site, I think, in most parts of India. But I mean, we've delivered about 2,000 apartments in Karjat over the last 4 years, and we have currently 99% occupancy. So I think people who need a house to live in, if they're within walking distance of a local train line, they'll definitely go and live. It's a question of how you sell as a developer. Are you selling to end users? Are you making a township livable? Are there amenities on the site? So I don't agree that we're many years away from habitation. We've got, over 8,000 people living in our first project in Karjat.
What kind of social infrastructure
do you
have in Karjat?
The issue has been actually from a customer's perspective, will the developer actually develop? Well, I mean, there's schools, there's the shopping malls, there's a small hospital, the colleges all around us. So, I mean, I think for affordable housing in particular, and Karjat in particular, we've seen many developers come and go who haven't delivered any inventory. So the customer, of course, has a trust deficit. I think across the board, in fact, in affordable housing, whether it's in Palghar or Bhuisar or Badlapur or whatever it is, that the developer is the key to making that township, a reality. And therefore, you're actually seeing demand being cannibalized to people who've delivered in the past, including to people like us. So whether it's us or the Godrejes or the Mahindras or the Tatas, you've seen people go towards branded developers who have a track record of delivering apartments within the set time frame. And, this trend will continue because smaller developers are facing their own sets of issues. The townships simply aren't large enough to actually have, livable amenities. I mean, our township in Badlapur now is over 10,000, people living there. The school started from pre-primary to secondary. Mm-hmm. There's an ICU hospital that's basically starting in 7 or 8 months. All the amenities on the site are basically ready. So it's important to deliver a living township to your people coming and living on the site. The moment you're able to do that, there's an advantage over the competition because other people haven't done it, obviously. So you see, of course, some increase in price. I mean, my view is the following on investment. If you're an end user looking to buy an apartment, buy with a branded developer where there's already existing water, people are living on the site, electricity, amenities are running. And you probably see 8 to 10% appreciation. For an investor, personally speaking, I just invest in debt. You're making 8, 10, 12% right now in this market with all this volatility, stock market going up and down 7, 8% in a day. The market's up 2.5% today. So the volatility is what kills, the confidence of a retail investor. So I would just, personally speaking, if you had money to invest, put it on debt, and don't touch it for a year, and then see how the market actually goes.
Amit Goenka, is your money in debt?
Yeah, exactly. So I'm glad there are very few developers who actually support us giving debt and earning debt returns. So I'm glad at least Rohit is supporting me, because people have already talked about how debt is an expensive proposition and how one should not be in debt.
No, but I think to be fair, what Rohit meant was if you're a retail investor, and by debt he means a fixed deposit.
Yes.
He doesn't mean your 25% mezzanine debt funding that you're giving to builders right now.
No, that is true. I mean,
that is exactly
debt,
right.
Well, you can earn 6% in the bank, or you can earn 20% with us. You know, that's a matter of choice. But I do agree with Rohit, and in general, it's not an investor market. See, at the end of the day, a lot of this infrastructure, which you know Rohit is building, a lot of good developers are building, and I don't mean to say that they're not good developers. I think there's some very seriously good developers who are actually going and building affordable housing. And now with the government's push, with the chief minister backing it up, you know, the entire way, I think there's a huge potential. But you know, these are new locations. These are locations which still the masses need to discover. Okay, there is not that much of influx of commute, of transport systems,
etc. I want to bring in Amit Grover also, because I want to understand right now, where is DLF looking at bringing in new commercial space? So we know Amit's in Gurgaon, we know everything that the DLF has done in Gurgaon, we know all of the traditional spaces that you occupy. Tell us what the new neighborhoods are that you're considering. Maybe stuff you haven't announced yet.
We are focusing on the core locations, which continue to be, you know, where there's larger demand from the global IT majors are there. So we're expanding in Gurgaon. We've recently announced a project in Gurgaon as part of the Cyber City. We're expanding our Chennai IT SEZ. So very much in the core locations, because we've seen larger demand from the IT ITS still remains in the six or seven cities, you know, and we're fortunately to be present in five of them. We're expanding existing in these locations, and would peripherally, you know, very carefully are looking at some of the extended suburb locations, which may come up based on the demand. So certainly about 3 million square feet, which we have rolled out, are planning to roll out, is in Gurgaon and Chennai to start with.
What about when you say peripheral suburbs and some sort of peripheral business districts? Can you tell us the few that you're considering?
Well, as the IT industry matures and the main central locations, although it deliver much more value, but at the same time, if they're larger customers looking at extended Gurgaon, let's say for example, we would explore opening up some build-to-suit projects depending upon the need of the customer. And that would give both an advantage of good price at an extended location and would have the advantage of developing an ecosystem at a new location.
What about Bangalore and Pune? Are you doing any peripheral business districts there?
We intend to do something in Pune as well. In Hinjewadi is an attractive market, which is historically has been very strong with the large IT majors. We intend to do something in Hinjewadi as part of the future developments. It's been a promising market. Pune has been very strategic in terms of getting employment workforce both from the Navi Mumbai as well as the Pune market. So Hinjewadi has been very strategic as a location. We would be looking at it as we go along.
And what about Bangalore?
Bangalore is something which, you know, it's an established market. At this stage, we are not looking at Bangalore. But yes, there is overall, we are aware there is good demand and growth happening in Bangalore. We are not present in Bangalore at this stage.
Where is your SEZ in Chennai, Amit?
This is on the Mount Panamali Highway. This is next to the Guindy in Chennai. And it's been a very promising asset with almost 100% occupied. We've had some need of our existing clients expanding, and that encouraged us to start a new two more developments, in fact two more blocks within the existing SEZ.
How many square feet will you be delivering in those two more blocks, and when will they be ready?
That's about 800,000 square feet, and they will be ready in about 16 months from now. It's actually partly built up. If you just have to raise from the ground floor upwards.
Mm-hmm. All right. Amit Goenka, quick closing comment from you. Gurgaon, Hinjewadi, not Bangalore right now, Guindy in Chennai, these are all traditional neighborhoods. So again, if there's jobs being created in a neighborhood, they will obviously create some sort of rental demand and then eventually some sort of housing demand as well. Should I be looking at these neighborhoods as well as an investor?
Well, certainly, wherever you're looking at not just IT dependency, but now the renewed manufacturing dependency. And I actually quite take Amit Grover's point on the SEZ. In fact, recently we've been involved in an SEZ in Chennai as well, where we've seen a huge amount of offtake by international majors, including Japanese conglomerates, UAE conglomerates, etc. Mm-hmm. Actually, picking up more and more space on almost 20 lease terms as well, which shows their ability and their intent to stay put in those markets for a very long term. From a consolidation, from a logistics, from a micro market perspective, these are fantastic locations. So Guindy really stands out, basis this entire manufacturing and IT hub centricity. Hinjewadi, of course, becomes slightly more IT center. Sure. I would rather move on the automobile belt going forward, which is really where the Talegaon, Chakan and the Pimpri-Chinchwad belts seem to gain the most. Hinjewadi seems to, I think, yes, it's a great market, it's already established. Phase 1, Phase 2, Phase 3 are going on, even extensions of Phase 3 now up and running. But clearly, I think the shift gradually will be more towards the Talegaon, Chakan, the more manufacturing hub, Pimpri-Chinchwad side, where I think really the upside remains to be seen. It's been subdued, it's been kind of flattish. Sure. But I think the largest upsides and Gurgaon again. I would rather go towards Sona Road, more towards the Bhiwadi, more towards the northern periphery of Gurgaon, because Gurgaon again has become very congested, very pervasive when it comes to infrastructure development. So clearly people need to look outside, look on the ring roads, look at the national corridors and see how they can actually start developing new infrastructure out there. So really the push is moving out there. We've seen a huge amount of upside come up in plotting projects, for example, in the Bhiwadi belt, in that micro market where people are going and buying plots and they're appreciating very fast. Clearly shows the story which we saw in Anand in Gujarat, in some of the other industrial belts where prior
but
to...
But Amit, this is my question. If someone puts up, let's assume there's a certain space, okay? There's a space that we go to Amit Grover with and say, put up commercial space here. There's an IT company that will come and occupy it. The IT company will employ people who can go out and rent, go out and buy. And we know IT employees have a pattern. They start at a two-bedroom, then they upgrade to a three-bedroom, then they upgrade to a villa. That's how it functions. Now, if you put in a factory, it's very likely that only the top management of that factory will actually be able to afford to buy homes, able to afford to upgrade their homes. In that case, where are you going to see the, the price growth come from and the demand come from?
It's very simple. Have the non-HR, the non-top management actually, as your target population, as your infill population, then clearly, you're first starting with rental homes for them. So number of investors do go in, which is really where the rental yield model for bulk of the second, third home buyers come in. They're not really necessarily using it for their own consumption. They're using it for
what sort of rental yields can I expect from an industrial belt?
Well, I think they're slightly better off than the traditional micro markets, which are more mainstream, more CBD types. CBD rental yields are more like 2.5-3% at best, whereas they tend to be, in Bangalore, for example, you can expect as high as even 6-7% rental yields.
Where?
In Electronic City, for example, you have a 1 BHK, people are willing to pay as much as 20,000 rupees, per month as rents. Okay. Whereas the capital values are actually more in the 4,000 bucks per square foot range. So the rental yields in some of the areas tend to be very, very high because they are really where what's available to them in the and eventually they look to buy them out. They eventually then look to upgrade them. That's really where the story starts to get built out. So nobody's expecting an escalation of these valuations overnight.
Sure. All right. We have Rohit on the phone line from Mumbai who has a question for us. Rohit, go ahead. What's your question?
Yeah, hi, ma'am. I have a query regarding I'm planning to buy one BHK flat for investment purpose. The budget is somewhere around 25 lakhs to 30 lakhs.
Okay.
I have looked one or two properties in Virar side. So is it advisable currently to enter in this Virar market? Or any other suggestion from here?
Any other suggestion from here? Rohit Poddar, and this is purely an investment. Rohit Poddar, here's someone who has 20 to 35 lakh rupees as an investment. He's looking at buying one bedroom in Virar. Is there a better option for him in the market?
I wouldn't say so. I think the prices in Virar have actually fallen by about 20-25% in the last 1 year. And there's a lot of oversupply in that market for the foreseeable future. So I wouldn't bet on it at this point of time. He's better off going to markets like Kalyan, for example, where there's a significant demand-supply gap. And he can still buy a 1 BHK flat in some locations there for this price. And you could probably expect a 15% appreciation there over the next 1 year.
On what basis are you predicting a 15% appreciation in Kalyan?
Well, I'll give you our own experience. We actually launched a project about 7 months back, and some formats of flats have actually gone up about 20%. The others have gone up about 10%. I personally think that the prices in Kalyan have actually moved up a lot. You know, and typically speaking, a 1 BHK flat's, you know, over 30 lakhs of rupees. So if you can find, for example, a small format 1 BHK flat, maybe for 25, 30 lakhs of rupees, the upside is actually quite large, because flats typically sell on absolute value, right? Mm. So if you're going to compare, for example, a larger size 1 BHK flat for a smaller size 1 BHK flat, the smaller size 1 BHK flat will have a high absorption rate.
Sure.
and also a quicker resale, you know, time frame. And we've seen from our own developers about, you know, over 6,000-8,000 flats over the last 4 years that they've actually developed, that the smaller size flats basically have a much higher resale value as compared to larger size flats. So if you take, for example, our own developments across the central suburbs, within the same site, you have a different price points for larger size flats versus smaller size flats. So the absolute ticket size matters a lot. And Kalyan actually has a demand supply gap for this particular ticket size. You know, people have been making larger size apartments there for a long time, more in the luxury space. And there's actually a demand supply gap in the entry level 1 BHK. Category.
Let me
say that over the next 2 or 3 years in particular, there's a good chance of a good upside.
Let me bring in Rohit one more time. This is Rohit on the phone line who's asking the question. Rohit, are you open to, you know, maybe considering a Kalyan instead of the Virar that you initially, you know, on your list?
Yeah, I am open because it is just an investment option. So, although I have one property in Kalyan, this was the second buy which I was looking in another different location, because the logic was very simple. Already I have one property in Kalyan, so if a different location was in mind, I think that was only.
What kind of returns have you gotten from your investment in Kalyan?
Currently?
Yes.
Currently there is an I bought one BHK last year, two years back, somewhere around 33. So now there is an appreciation somewhere around 36-38 lakhs. So in 2 years time frame, almost 4 to 5 lakhs have been appreciated approximately.
All right, Amit Goenka, interesting question. Of course, he's doing well in Kalyan. He possibly wants to diversify into another neighborhood. Rohit Poddar, they're telling us that Virar might not be a great choice. Is there another choice other than Kalyan right now for that ticket size?
Well, one could then look at Navi Mumbai rather than going on the Western Belt.
Navi Mumbai is not the same ticket bracket, right? He'll have to go even further.
He'll
away
have
from
to go further down. That's right. So basically, that is the Panvel, new Panvel area. Because now that we're talking about the airport, we're talking about Naina now actually getting effective. The entire CIDCO becoming a very, very overactive body with the number of projects that have been started and haven't really taken off, you know. So I really see now that with the thrust on the airport, and with the CM actually taking cognizance of the fact that CIDCO needs to step up its act, Naina needs to start functioning, you know, projects need to start taking off, actually one can start looking at the Nabi Panvel area for really the same sort of
what about neighborhoods like Ambarnath or Badlapur, further down from Thane,
so
up 25%.
I agree. I was actually going to say that there are two options. One is you further go down, so there's KDMC. Clearly KDMC is a great choice, the Kalyan Dombivli Municipal Corporation. Very rich corporation, huge amount of infrastructure development, very progressive, is coming up with a new master plan, is approving projects very quickly. There's huge infrastructure development happening in the Kalyan Dombivli belt. But clearly one can go into a Badlapur, into a Karjat, into some of these new markets, which is again developing, has a good 5-year, 7-year story building up for itself. But if you want to get away from the central line, then I could look at a Navi Mumbai, you know, a Panvel, new Panvel story, especially now with CIDCO and Naina becoming a very, very active story. So if you're looking, if effectively looking at a 5-year horizon, you know, one way or the other, you know. So given those two choices, I would be agnostic to either of them then.
All right, so these are the options you have, Rohit. If you heard our guests, Virar not a great choice, there's Ambarnath, there's you know, there are other options maybe in Navi Mumbai that you'd like to consider.
One can and go in Kalyan also again.
Yes, so if you need any more help, you know how to get in touch with us. Our contact details are on your screen right now. I have to take a break, but I want to thank all three gentlemen for joining us on the show this evening and helping us answer questions, helping us understand how Make in India is going to impact the real estate market.